Happy Wednesday, y'all. Tis the season for Halloween. We're not actually going to talk much about Halloween. We are going to attempt to make a couple of things. Hey, friend.
Hi.
How's it going?
I'm good.
Happy Wednesday.
Happy to you.
I really like that we do this in the middle of the week.
Yeah.
For me, mentally, it's a great thing that I look forward to every week.
I do too.
And so whenever I'm having a rough week, I always look forward to Wednesday. It really, like, I love this group. I love our community. I love their interaction with us. I love that they ask questions.
We have an amazing community.
We really do.
That's why I posted about us being a symphony, because it takes all of us.
Yeah.
And all of you that are asking those questions, we couldn't do it without your questions. You couldn't get answers unless we knew what you needed.
Right.
So let's keep making this beautiful music, because we love giving it to you.
I love helping people. It gives me purpose and it brings me joy. So I am just so glad that we get to serve this community. So if you're with us, please say hello in the chat. We are watching your comments. We will answer questions as you ask them. Please say hi. If you're from a country that's not the US, please tell us what country you're watching from, because
Hi, Ivy.
I was hoping you were going to be on. You said you were going to be here. Welcome. We're so happy you're here. So today, I guess I'm just going to jump right in.
Is it frozen for you guys?
No, there. We just have a different screen. So here's how we set this up. For those of you that are new, we have this set up, and then we have a computer in front of us so we can read your comments. It's really important to us that we can answer your comments in real time.
Hi, Janet.
So lovely of you to join us again, my dear.
I'm not sure what's going on here. But
so I'm going to ignore that part.
Yep.
Today we're talking about esophageal dysphagia. So in the month of October, we touched on, hi Megan, nice to see you.
Hello, ladies.
We touched on dysphagia, the overall topic. Mm-hmm. The next week, we talked about oral, so just the mouth. Last week, we talked about pharyngeal, and now we're talking about the esophagus.
Yep.
We're also going to puree a couple of things. So I roasted
spaghetti.
I roasted spaghetti squash. So we're going to puree a little bit of spaghetti squash. We have, I brought the box up here so I can show everybody. It's a quinoa blend. I went to Aldi this week. If y'all have Aldi nearby you, will you comment Aldi in the comments so we know? Because we want to make sure when we give you recommendations that you have access to some of these things. So I went to Aldi this week. I bought a bunch of bread because we're doing some fun things with bread right now.
We are doing some fun things with bread.
We can't wait to share with you. Awesome. Okay. So this quinoa blend, quinoa and brown rice, it's rosemary and olive oil flavored. So we're going to blend a little bit of that tonight and see how that goes. I also got this 90-second whole grain brown rice packet that's a microwavable one. We'll maybe do that in the future. But that's another great option that's quick and easy. Mm-hmm. And this should puree well.
It should.
So we'll try that in the near future. And then we have a little bit of ham that we experimented with beforehand because we weren't sure if it was going to work. Mm-hmm. So it's already pureed. If you've watched us in the past and you've seen us have trouble pureeing ham, it never quite turns out right. It's got a lot of texture. We can walk you through that if you're interested, because pureeing ham is, I thought it was impossible.
It's not impossible.
This was the best we've done.
Right.
But this took a lot of time and effort and manpower and machine power.
It did take some, yes.
And then we're going to do a pumpkin. We got a lot of stuff we're going to puree. So hopefully we'll get through it all. If not, we'll save some for next week. We've got a couple of candy bars. I have some little miniature Three Musketeers in here. We're going to do a quick little, hey Kara, Aldi's is in Fort Wayne. Kat, are you in Fort Wayne? We're in the South Bend area.
Yeah.
How cool is that?
Not too far from
us. Yeah, not far from us at all. So we're going to do a couple of candy bars and do like some shakes. I also have Milky Ways and I have Snickers that we can try if anyone is interesting. Hey, Karen, welcome. Okay, so I'm going to pop these in the microwave, these three musketeers in the microwave.
Okay.
And just let them start to melt. I'll put them on like the melt chocolate so they don't blow up. And let's start on the esophagus.
There's a melt chocolate?
There's a melt chocolate. Well, mine has it. I'm going to check and see if yours has it.
It may.
So
no, all I know is the popcorn.
Hi, Jenna from the UK. Welcome. So happy you're here.
Jenna, you are up late.
She's up very late.
I'm glad you don't have a bedtime. Welcome to the show.
So, Kat, yeah, we're like an hour and a half from you. How funny is that? I love it. So, okay. So, first to get us started with the esophagus. The esophagus is the tube that runs from your pharynx or your cavity where the swallow happens for the most part. If I'm wrong, Stephanie will correct me.
That's general enough.
To your stomach. On average, it's 10 to 13 inches long.
Mm-hmm.
On average. This is just, there are variants. Some people's are shorter, some people's are longer. And they're about 3/4 of an inch wide at the widest point. We haven't mentioned that tidbit before.
We haven't.
So I'm going to let you get started with the rest when I pop this in.
So I wanted to talk just a little bit. Basically, esophageal dysphagia is a medical condition characterized by difficulty swallowing. I don't know if it's my connection, but your screen flashes green, but it doesn't affect the audio. So I'm having trouble too. I wonder if I, let me check something quick.
That's really interesting. Okay.
I know. I don't know. I think I might
close out of here.
I might close it and restart. So for the five of you that are here, I am going to stop it.
It's fine for Megan.
Oh.
Okay. So we're going to close it and we're going to pop it open again. The picture should not stop because we're not closing that. We're just doing what's on our, I wonder if it's the internet. I'll shut my computer down.
Well, if it's not a problem for
some people.
Megan, I have a hearing. Not. Watching on the computer. Okay, I'm going to just X out.
All right, everybody. So I have some chocolate going. It set it up for 4 ounces, which there's no way that was 4 ounces. That was maybe an ounce.
Yeah.
So we will...
Are we going to start with dessert, with the shake?
I'm starting with dessert. Who else wants to start with dessert?
I like it. Let's do it.
Okay. So the other thing I got at Aldi was these vanilla protein shakes. They appear to be the equivalent of Premier protein, but they're like half the cost for four.
Crazy, because they're not cheap.
No, protein shakes are not cheap, but a lot of people need them. And I like to do them anytime we do something dessert-wise because we want to get sweet, good-tasting stuff in because our brains want that, especially if you're having trouble with weight. But we want it to be high-calorie, high-protein, still good for you. So what we're going to do is we have teacups because we like to just, we'll just let it go. We got the count comments, so that's the important part. So we're just going to taste this to start. This is a vanilla whey protein shake. So we're just going to give it a splash to taste.
Oh, you're doing it in the cups?
Well, just to taste.
We're tasting. Sorry. I wasn't paying attention.
It's not half bad. Tastes like vanilla. Okay. So.
That's actually kind of good.
Yeah. I don't dislike that.
Tastes like Carnation Instant Breakfast. That reminds me of my childhood.
There you go. Okay.
So it's actually good.
So cheaper than your typical Premier if you have Aldi. So I'm just going to pour a little bit in here and see if we can make a little bit of... I might have microwaved it too long because if you know anything about chocolate, you know that it doesn't like to be. Okay.
We can blend it.
We're going to blend it. All right. So here we go. I'm going to do the short one. Okay. Make sure it flashes so that. Okay. So I'm going to
That is two fun size or?
Two fun size.
No, miniature.
They were the small ones.
Two miniature.
Mm-hmm.
Three musketeers.
Three musketeers, yeah. So I don't know that I needed to necessarily microwave them. And that was way too long. However long I did was way too long. So. Chocolate does not like to be heated. This is one of the important things that I learned in culinary school 15, 18 years ago, something like that. You should not heat chocolate above like 98 degrees. It does not like to get hot. Bad things happen to chocolate when it gets hot. It also doesn't like to be mixed with water. It seizes. And then it has a weird texture and we don't like it. So,
but it does like to be mixed with milk.
It does like to be mixed with milk, just not water. I don't see much.
No, it looks like it.
Okay. So we have a little Three Musketeers
protein
drink. I also have Snickers and Milky Way. Of course, the Snickers, I half expect will not puree well.
Ooh, I like it.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's good. I like it better than a Three Musketeers by itself.
I did get a touch of the nougat.
I did.
But it melts still. So if you have trouble swallowing, leave it on your tongue. I got just a touch. That's delightful. It reminds me of a hot chocolate.
It does.
But with like oomph to it.
So it reminds me of hot chocolate, but the you know how when you were a kid you had the melted marshmallows on top?
Mm-hmm.
It kind of tastes like the melted marshmallows on top. So okay. I bet that nougat is what's given that flavor.
Microwave for like 10 seconds and let them
just to kind of
melt a little bit. And then blend it with some vanilla protein shake or chocolate protein shake if you need the extra chocolate. Okay. So I'm going to do a Snickers one, and then I think we should also get started.
Maybe if you melt it with some of the milk in it.
Good point. Let's try that.
And just for those who weren't here, this is a protein shake from Aldi. Less expensive, but 30 grams mm-hmm. per.
It's comparable to Premier Protein.
Right.
They only have the chocolate and vanilla, but the other thing I want to try, which I'm going to do with our pumpkin thing that we're going to make, is that they have whey protein blend at Aldi as well. This was $18 as opposed to your typical protein blend that's upwards of $20 and up to like $55, depending on what you buy. So if this is halfway decent, we're going to give it a try. We're going to see what happens because we're talking about protein all the time, and everybody needs extra protein, mm-hmm. Especially with esophageal stuff going on. I mean, I shouldn't say that. Especially with any dysphagia at all going on, you need extra protein. Mm-hmm. Your muscles cannot maintain what they have and cannot improve without the extra protein. So, let's talk
about some of the causes of esophageal dysphagia.
What causes this tube to malfunction or to not work.
Yeah. So the first one that they have on the list, or that is on, I think that's a good idea, that's on the list is that there is a mechanical obstruction. So there is something obstructing the movement mm-hmm. of food
yep.
through the esophagus.
Yep.
That can happen for it could be a number of things.
Yeah.
There could be a hernia in there.
Mm-hmm.
Like an esophageal hernia or
a hiatal hernia where your stomach comes up through your diaphragm a little bit and gets in the way.
Mm-hmm.
That can cause a lot of problems. Did it work? Make sure I don't scorch it again.
Right. So, you could have a stricture.
Yep.
Where your esophagus is tighter in one spot than other areas. And so bigger pieces or bigger amounts of food don't go through. Mm-hmm. And then it creates a backup, mm-hmm. if you want to look at it like that way. Or sometimes for those people who are able to swallow or accidentally swallow very large pieces of food,
yep.
like bread or meat,
yep.
It could get lodged in there whether there's a stricture or not.
Yeah.
So
one of the things I want to go back to before we go any farther is that the esophagus has a ton of nerves and blood vessels going to it. There are so many. So there are cervical, thoracic, and lumbar intervention from your nervous system to your esophagus, okay? The esophagus does not move food from the top to the bottom with gravity. Gravity does not play a role here, okay? That's important.
Gravity does not play a role here.
Yes. So there are waves of peristalsis. So what they do is one wave will push stuff down, and then the next wave will push stuff down, and then the next wave will push stuff down. And it's just like that. Typically, after a normal swallow, food takes about 7-ish seconds to get from your mouth to your stomach, typically. If there's dysmotility, mm-hmm. or if there's that lack of waves, then your esophagus doesn't push food down like it's supposed to, and then we have to rely on gravity, which doesn't actually work like we think it should for our esophagus.
Right.
Okay.
So can someone please just give us, I don't care if you give us, oh, good. Okay, so do these waves so they can hear us.
Mm-hmm.
So it's good. Just something on
our end that's
I
not
shut
working.
Down the whole computer. Yep. So do these waves control the swallow, and is the swallow separate from the esophagus?
This is a great stepping question.
It is a great question. Yes, the swallow itself, so the initiation of the swallow, is at a different level. So the initiation of a swallow and the part that is so vital, mm-hmm. is at the pharyngeal level, because at the pharyngeal level, which we covered last week, is where that decision, and there's no decision being made, it's the muscle control, whether it goes airway or whether it goes esophagus, is in the pharyngeal level. So once it leaves the pharyngeal level, it is at the esophageal level. So that is totally separate. However, I have to say, and we'll probably reach this later, that if you have esophageal issues long enough, it can begin to create issues with that the pharyngeal level.
Yep. So in the throat.
At the pharynx.
In the throat.
So.
Yeah.
In the throat. Yes. So can the peristalsis stop part way down? Yes. So you may have bigger issues with the upper half of the esophagus, or you may have issues with the lower half of the esophagus, or the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
There's no way to know unless you go and have
manometry
testing done.
Manometry is the test, right?
Typically, yes.
Yeah. So having these tests done is really important for knowing what's going on in your body.
Mm-hmm.
The manometry test is not comfortable, and a lot of people really struggle with that. So, yes, I have a peristalsis from the mid to distal portion, mm-hmm. of my esophagus. So mm-hmm. middle to the end. So distal distance. So Megan, you have that on Monday. You got this?
Okay. Yes, you can do this.
If you want to reach out on Monday before, please do. We're here for you. You know how to reach us.
And I just want to refer to Karen. She says she has a peristalsis from the mid to distal portion of esophagus. So that's very important. So that's one where we would talk about. So if you have problems with the bottom half, it could fill up and back up to the pharyngeal level, and that's when you start feeling things not moving. You have sensations that you wouldn't normally feel if food kept going down.
Right.
So, is there any alternative to testing? My mother is bedridden and is unable to be tested.
So, I would say we address it with food from here on out. Elizabeth, if yes. testing is not necessarily an option,
we'd have to take it slow.
Yeah.
So, I have done a lot of therapy where testing is not possible. You just have to take it very slowly in the testing phases.
Okay.
I've had manometry and they said I failed 100% on the lower end of the esophagus. Wow, Janet.
Okay. So the lower end, I feel like we divide it into three sections, the upper, the mid, and the lower. So, Janet, this happens often. And then we talk about other strategies then on how to get that food pushed into your stomach. We want your lower esophageal sphincter. So on the esophagus, and going back to the anatomy, on the tube, there's a sphincter at the top and there's a sphincter at the bottom, right? So this is the lower esophageal and this is the upper esophageal. After you swallow, your upper esophageal closes. And then your esophagus does its thing. And then the lower esophageal opens to let food out and then closes. So we want that sphincter to be strong because this is where we end up with problems like reflux. If that lower esophageal sphincter opens when it's not supposed to, that's when we end up with reflux. What's happening?
Nothing's happening. I'm okay. Just looking something up.
Figuring something out? Yeah. Okay. So Ivy, regards to manometry diagnosed with IEM, just incomplete swallows. Ivy, I think in order for Stephanie to answer that question, she would need to meet with you via video.
By IEM, are you talking about intermittent esophageal movement? What?
Okay. I'm trying the Snickers
incomplete
one.
Swallows. Incomplete swallows tells me that it's at a pharyngeal level. If they're telling you it's incomplete swallows, it tells me that there's not enough strength to do a full swallow. Okay. That everything is not coming together.
Yeah. Okay.
At the pharyngeal level.
Yep. So Janet just had Nissen.
Oh.
For a hiatal hernia. I reached out to ask how it had gone and how she was doing and whatnot, I think last week, because it was very recent, if I'm not mistaken, Janet. So it's one of those things where we have to allow for recovery time.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're ready for the Snickers, this is Snickers.
I'm going to try the Snickers. There's no chunkies in it.
I didn't see any, but there's a few.
Uh-huh.
It needs to be. So the Snickers probably need to be strained. So 3.5 weeks ago. Yeah. Snickers needs to be strained, but you still get the flavor.
But it's yummy. If I didn't have to deal with the
pieces,
the chunks of peanut.
Mm-hmm. So I wonder if we could do a Milky Way with a little bit of peanut butter. If it would be similar. That can be Maybe. An experiment for another day because we don't have the stuff out for Maybe. That. But so this is just a couple of ideas for Janet. Try it with a Mars bar. Let us know. And like I said, use either a vanilla or a chocolate protein shake because you're still going to get pretty good nutrition. You don't have to feel guilty about having a candy bar. Mm-mm. It's not a ton. I mean, it was the little bite size, the minis, right? So try it. And I did heat the candy bar in the protein shake to soften it this time, and it worked way better. So, okay. So let's puree. We're going to move on a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Dump that in my glass. Move on.
I'm drinking.
And we're going to do...
So is it common to have early...
Mm-hmm.
To the point that you always feel full and have zero appetite?
I would say no, that tells me there's something going on with the gut-brain connection. So the vagus nerve is the longest nerve in your body, and it runs from, of course, your central nervous system into your diaphragmatic area. And we see that that controls a lot of satiety and intervention. So if you're having early satiety, I would be concerned that something's going on in your stomach. Your hunger hormones are your signals, your hormone signals that deal with hunger are off. And I would be concerned there's something else going on.
Well, and truthfully, I mean, it could come from an esophageal issue and initially. It could be that you've not put enough in your stomach to actually understand the difference between hunger and
fullness.
Being full. It could, but that usually would be over a long period of time mm-hmm. that it would change the signal mm-hmm. that the brain is receiving. Did it charge?
It's most of the way there.
Okay. I forgot to charge. So it's mostly charged. So let's talk a little bit more about motility. We talked about motility in the contractions, contraction, relaxation.
I'll get to your question in just a minute, Megan. Okay, I promise. Hold tight, and I'll answer it. And Karen. Yeah, Karen, you know me, always looking out for the nutrition piece. Absolutely. So we're gonna talk about this, and I'll get back to you, Megan. I promise.
Okay, so there are motility disorders that will affect the ability for the esophagus to have that squeezing and relaxing that will help to move mm-hmm. the food and liquid down. One of those would be achalasia. You could have spasms of the esophagus. Mm-hmm. There are a number of reasons that that could be happening. We won't get into that today. That's more medical mm-hmm. and not part of what we
would typically
manage or be able to diagnose.
Right. Right. A test would have to diagnose that.
Right. Another esophageal cause of esophageal dysphagia.
Leave it. Go. There was a candy bar wrapper that he got. Sorry.
Come on.
I dropped it.
Come on. So GERD. How many of you have GERD? So GERD is gastroesophageal. Sorry, Ivy. This is one of my pets that just thinks that he's...
Someday, we're going to have an office where the puppies are not invited. But
someday soon.
Until that day. Sorry.
So, GERD. So, Megan, thank you.
I do, too.
Gastroesophageal reflux disease. That can cause esophageal dysphagia because mm-hmm. with consistent...
acid
reflux mm-hmm. of acid coming from the stomach, mm-hmm. it can technically burn the membranes of the esophagus.
Yep.
So then that changes, and the longer you have that, the thicker the burn gets.
Yeah.
So it can cause those mucous membranes to not move like they should mm-hmm. anymore.
So now I'm going to answer your question on the chocolate. My first question for all of you is, if you have reflux, what are your triggers? Mm-hmm. If chocolate triggers reflux for you in any capacity, don't have the chocolate. Or be hyper aware of the fact that you're going to have symptoms because of it. So it's really important to know what your triggers are. If your triggers are dairy, if your triggers are chocolate, if it's coffee, if it's wine, if it's tomato products, it could be anything. I know a lady recently who told me that she could eat a cucumber and she would have terrible reflux for hours. And so just because dietitians and doctors and GI specialists talk about the typical triggers doesn't mean that those are the only ones. It's really important for you to know your body and track your symptoms so you can, what's the word I'm looking for? You can correlate it with mm-hmm. what the food is. So chocolate typically doesn't give me reflux. Janet says gluten does it for me. Yes, that is what I'm talking about. So just because that's not a typical reflux trigger doesn't mean that's the case for everyone. So know your triggers. If chocolate typically triggers you, play it safe. If this amount, if you can be okay with one,
then indulge.
Then
eat
have
the chocolate.
Because the protein should help with the digestion at that point. Lynn says mint. Yes. Mint is a huge one because, and I don't eat mint. I try not to eat mint. I try not to take mint candy or mint gum or mint anything because mint is one of those relaxants that causes that lower esophageal sphincter to relax.
And then blah, blah, blah.
And then it bubbles up for me. So yep. Like I used to love peppermint tea and then I'd get terrible reflux afterwards because my stomach got all relaxed and my sphincter went, oh, you don't need me right now. I'll be fine. Terrible reflux. So
it's
yes.
Like being at the spa and smelling all that.
Yeah. I mean, so just know your triggers. That's what I want to tell you about chocolate. If it bothers you, avoid it. If it doesn't bother you, you can have one.
Yeah.
Or
so
just know.
There's a question earlier about if that is the case, can it heal?
So let's talk about this. So with going back to anatomy.
There it is.
I didn't talk about, and Ivy said, can it be reversed? So let's talk about anatomy a little bit. So your stomach is this organ that is built for harsh conditions, yep. Right? Hydrochloric acid, it has a pH of like 1. Yeah. I don't know. It's very harsh. If you get it on your skin, it will burn you, okay? So your esophagus is not built for harsh conditions. So your lower esophageal sphincter is really, really, really important. Okay. We'll catch you later, Megan. You're welcome. So what happens is the cells in your stomach look like this, right? All lined up next to each other. They're long and they're big and they're protective. Okay. The cells of your esophagus look like this. And they're all lined up next to each other. So the cells in your esophagus are like your skin. Okay? They're soft. They're pliable.
And they're...
If you get acid on it, it burns.
Right.
Okay? So what happens when you have long-term acid, for people that don't end up with swallowing disorders, sometimes they end up with what we call a precancerous condition called Barrett's esophagus. Does this mean you're going to get cancer? No, it does not. But this is your body's way of protecting you from the acid. So the cells of your esophagus start to look like this because they can adapt. Your body is amazing that it can adapt like this.
But it's a smaller space.
Correct.
And this is not going to move
correct
things around like little...
Yeah.
Little bitty things, like
so,
moving
so
things.
So if you
down.
Had this much space, now you only have this much space.
Right.
And it's going to create added pressure and it's going to be harder to get things through. So yes, if we catch this soon enough and we address it through food and through lifestyle type management, this can be healed and reversed. If we don't catch it in time... And it's already affected your nerves and your muscles, we may not get that back. So our goal is to catch it in time. We want you to get help now.
That's why it is very important to take the medicine that you are given to address your GERD. Don't just say, I don't like taking meds.
Mm-hmm.
Because I have people in my family who... Or like that.
And
it drives me crazy because I know that if you don't manage the acid,
yeah.
What can happen?
Right. So usually LES is loose and open, causing the acid to rise up. So reflux is common in my family. My brother has it. My dad has it. My guess is my grandfather had it. So there are certain things that you can eat that increase the pressure in your stomach, which helps your LES stay closed. These foods include protein. Why do I harp on protein all the time? Right?
For a number of reasons, but this is one good, really important reason when you have GERD.
Yes. So Karen, my guess is yours is not related to reflux. Based on all of that information, I would guess there's a separate cause and it's not reflux related. So reflux does not always mean you're going to have esophageal motility issues, but it's a risk factor. So if you have reflux, you may have esophageal issues, you may not.
And you may have other things that made that reflux even worse on your system. So it's hard. I don't want for us to blame everything on that. That is not the problem with everyone's.
It's not.
Because there are a lot of people out there who have reflux and don't have swallowing problems.
It's like saying smoking is responsible for cancer, but not everyone that smokes has cancer. It's along the same, like we know that it's a risk factor, but so bear with us. So,
and I know that a lot of people want answers to their dysphagia.
Right.
There may be so many answers that we can't find them all.
Correct. So Ivy, I would say for you, diet is going to be even more vital for you. So we need to figure out what your triggers are. We need to figure out what we can do to improve your nutritional status and go from there.
Right. Ivy, can we talk? Let's talk. Send us a direct message and we would love to talk with you.
Yeah.
Because you are the same as my son, and he did not like taking the medicine, and so we found other ways. So, good, love it.
Okay. I added a touch of water to my squash, and I'm going to add a touch of olive oil, even though I put olive oil in it to cook it.
Okay. So while we are moving on, because we have made it.
Not very far.
We have made it to here.
I love the questions today, you guys.
I do too.
Fabulous.
I'm so excited. There's 12 of you on right now. Welcome. If I have not said hello, I would love to know everybody that's here. I know some of you because you're asking questions, but I would like to know who's here. This is fantastic.
We love you guys. We want you to get the information that you want, and we can't give you the information unless you ask questions. So tell us what you need because we will work on getting it for you.
Right. And if we run out of time and Facebook kicks us off, it kind of looks like they've kicked us off, but you're asking questions so you see us.
Yeah.
So let's talk about the next cause. Mm-hmm. Does that smell good?
Yeah.
The next cause would be scleroderma.
Ooh. So this one we haven't talked before, but we've had questions about it lately.
We have. Scleroderma is actually an autoimmune condition.
I love talking about this.
That
Karen, you're amazing too. Karen Rabelais. I probably said your last name wrong. I don't think I've ever said it before. Anyway,
hi, Karen.
So glad you're here because what you have to offer our group is very valuable.
Yeah, and I can't wait to meet you because I've heard a lot of stuff about you.
You met her in June, but you probably just don't remember because
I met 50,000 people in June. But I can't wait to meet you again.
Yes.
So scleroderma, autoimmune condition that can affect the esophageal muscles.
Yes.
So autoimmune, that's
nutrition. We fixed that with nutrition.
Absolutely. So that's we're going to push you this way. However, it doesn't mean that it's only nutrition.
Mm-hmm.
If you have had, if you have issues that back all the way up to the pharyngeal level, we can talk because I believe you. There are so many people that are told it's an esophageal issue, it's autoimmune, speech therapists can't help you because they don't treat the esophagus. Well, I beg to differ. And sometimes the issues of the esophagus continue up over time, and let's talk.
Yep.
So I believe you. You are not alone, and send me a direct message.
Yep. So I pureed the spaghetti squash with a little bit of olive oil. I added more black pepper because we like...
Who doesn't like that black pepper?
For the people that don't, you don't have to add it. And then some salt. I'm also going to add... I have a little bit of protein from Unjury. That's French onion. I'm going to add a touch to this. I don't think I need to thicken it. Do I? It's kind of loose.
It's kind of loose.
It's probably going to go everywhere.
It won't hold in. Okay. At that level, it won't hold in these forms.
So will you pop me out a package of the Purethick thickener? Mm-hmm. I was going to talk about some other thickeners tonight too, but that's going to have to wait because we have other more important questions happening here. Hey, Karen, I'm glad they ruled that out for you too. Yeah. So that ruling things out is a good thing. So I want you guys to remember that as your doctors are ruling things out, don't get discouraged because that is a good thing.
Right.
It gets us closer to something else. All right.
And also for those of you who are questioning, should I go for this testing? The answer is yes. Mm-hmm. Go for the testing. We can help you through the next phase of it.
Yeah.
Afterward.
Do you need a pair of scissors? Sometimes those are difficult.
I got it.
Okay. It's like I threatened you with a pair of scissors in it. Okay. And that might be too much, but we're going to
find out. It wasn't as much as it looks like.
Here's the thing. Thank you, Cindy. My husband picked it out for me at Goodwill. He and his mom went to Goodwill, and he undressed a mannequin to get it for me, and I thought I would be festive for y'all tonight. Bless his heart. I love
She's
that
always
man.
The festive one, Cindy.
I try.
She is. It's true. Okay, so we were talking about autoimmune conditions, scleroderma. Mm-hmm. Let's also talk about esophagitis. So there's a number of different types of esophagitis or reasons for esophagitis. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The one most common that I'm hearing lately is the eosinophilic esophagitis, mm-hmm. Which causes an inflammation in the esophagus.
I have 5 pages of eating for esophagitis, so...
So
we can share that at another time too.
So that just goes to prove that your diet is very important in a lot of this stuff. And that's why speech therapy, swallowing therapy, and dietitian work so well for some of these conditions because we can address both.
Yep. Yes, we can.
And I'm very passionate about that. Can you tell?
Yes, I am too.
Okay. We both are very passionate about it. Karen, I had a diagnosis of esophagitis, but they ruled out EOE. Weird. No, it's not weird.
So let me clarify.
Not the only.
Any condition that has itis on the end, I-T-I-S, on the end means inflammation. So all it means is esophagus inflammation. So it could be tendinitis, which is tendon inflammation. So I just want to clarify that itis put on the end of a word just means something's going on that's causing inflammation and we may not know what it is. So itis, like, and I said this to a doctor one time, I said something with the itis on the end and he freaked out and I was like, will you calm down? I'm just using it to describe a feeling that I have. Like, I feel inflamed. And he was like, oh, okay. I was like, you're the doctor. You went, like, come on, guys. I get a little more technical than I should, I think, a lot of times, so it's okay. So I have quinoa and brown rice in my other blend jet. So I'm going to add a little bit of liquid, and we're going to puree this, and we're going to see how it goes.
Yeah.
And I'm going to add a little more of this protein, because even though quinoa has a decent amount of protein in it, if you have dysphagia, you can really never get enough protein.
Protein. Yes.
It's add your it. Friend.
If you can. If you have the opportunity.
It's my friend. It's Stephanie's friend.
Yes.
It's all our friends.
It is. So, esophagitis is an inflammation, as we were saying, in the esophagus, which, as you know, narrows the whole esophagus. So then you're creating problems. You could even create problems at the pharyngeal level because of the pressure... The back pressure from all of that inflammation. So an anti-inflammatory diet, great idea. Talk to Kat. She's ready for you. Send her a message.
Yep.
Send us a message. Well, it's pretty.
It's getting thick, but that's expected with anything starchy. It's going to get thick. We don't need to add thickener to this. I did add a little bit of protein. I'm going to add a little more olive oil.
So the other thing is we find that a lot of times adding a little bit of fat to your pureed items are going to help it to slide down.
Yes.
That's number one. It's easier to swallow, easier to move, especially if you have inflammation. Number two, if you have dysphagia, it's probably more difficult for you to get food in and down. So the more calories and nutrition that you can get per bite. So the extra oil, don't worry about it. It's only going to help.
Yeah, if you're worried about type of oil, this is something I'm very passionate about as well. My background, my education was in holistic nutrition. Mm-hmm. So I like to talk about the things that are anti-inflammatory, the things that are going to do good things for your body. Real butter, olive oil, coconut oil, are all gonna do good things for your body. They're not bad for you.
I'm gonna get a white plate because okay. I think it'll show better.
I wasn't sure where one was, to be honest. I also didn't look very hard. Okay. A lot of the foods you are using have a lot of fiber. So Ivy, I do try to add fiber for people that can handle it. There are people that cannot handle the fiber. So for those people, yes, you're correct.
Maybe red.
Ooh, we like red. That'll be a nice contrast. So I'm going to let you talk about the ham here in a few minutes once we get there too. I like fiber. Fiber is good for your digestive system unless you have some gastric motility. Okay, if you can't, then we go to simpler with you. We go to white rice. We go to things that are low fiber, and that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're feeling discouraged, that's okay. We tailor things to you, okay? We make it work for you, because you maybe need something different than me or Stephanie or Karen or...
Well, and don't be discouraged by this. A lot of people can't handle that kind of fiber.
Mm-hmm. For one reason or
another. A lot of people. There's you are not reasons. Alone in this, Ivy. This mm-hmm. is not the first time we've heard this.
Yep.
We go to fiber as a first line of defense, but if it doesn't work for you, we've got a plan for that. Don't worry mm-hmm. about that. Mm-hmm. We can yep. work with that. We can help you.
Okay.
Well, that's beautiful.
Yeah, it's kind of fun. I don't know that it's going to stick not. Up, but we're going to leave it here for a minute or two to see if it'll hold.
Yeah. Yep.
So good. This is the other thing, Ivy. We believe that anything we recommend, if it's not helpful to you, then it's not helpful to us. We want to make sure that we're tailoring your needs to you, because you are an individual. Mm-hmm. You are not everybody else. Everyone else has very specific needs. And this is why when I say people need to understand their triggers for whatever's causing symptoms in their body, we all have different ones. Raw apple does not like me. I love it. So I do cooked. Stephanie can't handle cooked. It's okay. It's okay. So
I'm learning to do cooked. I'm learning. It's more of a sensory thing.
I'm always impressed when you eat cooked fruit.
All right.
Okay. So, and here's the other thing. Don't ever let anyone tell you that you're wrong about yourself, about what's going on in your body. And this is why Stephanie made the comment of, I believe you, because you are the only person in your body.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody else is in your body. So if you need help learning how to put those things into words, I know a good speech therapist. Mm-hmm. So just, you know, we're here to help in more ways than just one
right.
or two. Okay. This may end up being a mess. And
it's not going to mold.
I didn't put enough thickener in here. Can y'all see this plate from where the camera's at? Because sometimes, oh yeah, there it goes. That's okay. All right. So we have, and some veggies are a little lower in fiber and they're helpful. We do take clients out of state. Ivy, we even take clients out of the country. Surprise. Okay. Elizabeth, thank you for that.
Okay,
I appreciate
good.
It.
So I'm okay, going to
Janet,
go.
Thank you.
This may be the only one that holds its shape.
It might be. Well, it'll be the prettiest one, though, with the is that a maple leaf?
It is.
Okay, so...
Where's our Canadian?
That's Janet.
Janet.
She's here.
Okay,
she's here.
Janet, we're making a maple leaf for you. I love it.
So with ham, we have pureed it in the past. We've made ham and bean soup. I don't know what else we made with it. And it just does not puree well. No matter what we've tried in the blend jet. So Stephanie.
So Kat and I are working on a lot of different pureed food type things. So what we did was we freeze dried ham.
Uh-huh.
And then we blended it when it was dry to get it to...
Mm-hmm. So it looks like this, and it's hard.
It's shelf-stable, freeze-dried.
It's got no moisture in it at all.
Zero water. And so then what we did was we took the ham and blended it while it was dry to get it into... to make it powder.
In a Vitamix.
I actually saved...
And we had to use the Ninja and swap it back and forth because...
So this is... I saved it. So this is what it looked like. It's just a powder. Mm-hmm. It's powdered, dried ham.
Yep.
But it started originally as a whole ham. It was actually a spiral cut ham that we freeze dried. And it's just a powder. And so we've added water to rehydrate after we powdered it.
Yep.
So it's very fine.
Okay. So we did add some oil, and Stephanie added a little bit of butter as well, because the oil and the butter helps with the texture a little bit. Okay. So we're working on some food ideas for people that need different things. And do we want to tell them about you're getting an exclusive, the 12 of you that are on right now? Ivy, is all meat prepared the same way? I'm going to say no. Everything has a little bit. Shannon, this is exactly where we're going with this. We are working on doing things specifically for this community because your needs are different than just like the camping stores.
Right.
And not everyone has a Vitamix. So we're starting with...
So we are starting a business plan. This is exclusive, that we can start providing freeze-dried pureed food for you.
And we're starting with bread.
Yes, we are. We are going to have a bread club.
Because I think one of the things that people miss the most is bread, because bread is... But here's the thing also. It doesn't matter what I think. It matters what you think and what you want. So we want your input. We want to know what you want to try. We want to know what foods you miss. We're starting with bread because bread's easy and bread is dangerous right there. So Ivy, the goal is to get you to a point where we can take freeze-dried bread and we powder it and then we show you how to rehydrate it and then you can make a sandwich.
Yep.
You may have to eat that sandwich with a fork or a spoon, but we teach you how to puree the meat. We do lettuce and tomato. We do pickle. We do... What am I missing? Cheese? We can do...
We made a peanut butter. So this weekend, Kat and I played around with it. We made salads cabina. Absolutely. Salads is one of my other things that I feel like people miss the most.
And we can do salads or pureed bread in beautiful little glasses and we can layer them.
Right.
And they could be delicious and beautiful. And all we have to teach... We have to just do the freeze drying part and then we send it to you. And we teach you, we make videos out of everything, of course, on how to do it.
How to use it. So Kat and I...
That's our goal.
...worked this past weekend, and we played around with some of our freeze-dried bread that we have, and we made cinnamon rolls, pureed cinnamon rolls, and it was quite literally rolled and as soft and smooth as you... We'll put pictures. We took pictures.
I think I did post one of them in one of the stories that I had.
So I know. Look, stories disappear.
Kara's got the... Okay.
Right. So stories disappear. So we may need to re-upload those.
This is why we want your feedback. Because if we're going to do this and it doesn't matter to you guys, then we're not going to do it. But if we can find you things that you want that we can make easy on you, and you can just say, I need to buy the little thing, and we'll teach you how to rehydrate it, and it's still got all the nutrition in it because freeze drying
saves all the nutrition.
Holds on to all that nutrition.
We're starting with bread. So yeah. Be on the lookout for the Dysphagia Bread Club.
Yes.
It's coming soon.
Yes.
To a Facebook near you.
Yes. So, oh, look.
Ooh. Oh!
I knew if I left it there long enough, it would.
Okay. That looks amazing!
So, this is the quinoa brown rice stuff.
Yes, with a little bit of gravy or a little bit
Karen
of...
Karen likes the bread club, too. Yeah.
Cinnamon roll. So, you betcha.
So here's the thing. We got bread from a local nursing home. And this is the pureed bread that you can't buy. They only sell it to hospitals and nursing homes. And that upsets me because you all could benefit from this. And I called them and I tried and they said no.
So we're making our own.
So we're doing it without them. Because who needs them if they're not going to give it to the people that actually need it? So, right. And this stuff is crap anyway. It's full of sugar. It, like, the second and third ingredient are sugar and sugar.
Two different.
It's not helpful.
Two different names for sugar are the second and third ingredients.
Yes.
Ours, truly,
came from a loaf.
A loaf.
So I went to Aldi yesterday and got all this other stuff to buy bread. Because who doesn't love bread?
Well, people miss sandwiches.
Yes.
They miss.
And
I know. I've done this for 30 years. People want to eat bread, from what I remember.
And Janet, FYI, we're going to do gluten-free also.
Yes. Actually, this right here is gluten-free. And this one is gluten-free.
But here's the other thing. We can do toast and we can do bread.
Yep.
And you can tell the difference. See? All right. I'm glad you're in. I love this. So my squash didn't hold its shape, but I didn't put enough thickener in there for it to hold its shape. If I had put enough thickener in, it would have been fine. The ham, we didn't put any thickener in at all.
It probably won't
so
hold.
So it probably won't hold either.
But.
That's fabulous.
It did. Look at that. It's so pretty.
All right. Can you all see this?
I love it. Hey, Bubby. You can't have it.
Can you all see this?
So we have
a
ham.
This is kind of fun, right?
We have a ham leaf, and we have a quinoa leaf, and we have...
A non-existent pumpkin leaf.
Well,
or
it's...
pumpkin leaf.
It's a squash pumpkin that's not a pumpkin.
Take a picture before I...
That is beautiful.
So let's try it.
Yes.
Okay?
Let's do it.
Because if it doesn't taste good, there's no point, right? Janet says it looks amazing. Thank you. Okay, good.
It was
good,
fun, good. Too.
Okay.
Okay, here we go.
So... Yes, it takes a little bit of time. Yeah, quinoa first. It has less texture than I expected.
It has a little bit of texture, mostly because of the quinoa.
But not
a lot. It's pretty smooth.
And the flavor's good.
So if you can handle a little bit of texture, that's perfect.
And you don't have to do it in a mold.
No.
You can do it a little thinner if you need it thinner.
And put it in a... Fun, yeah, or even in a cute,
you know, we like our teacups. If you've joined us before, you know, we love eating out of our teacups. Cat avocado ideas, we got you. Yes, we can do that. Okay, ham next. I'm getting squash in with my ham.
It's probably a good idea. So there's definitely a meat texture, but it's not different textures.
But
it's not different sizes of texture.
But it dissipates.
Very quickly.
Kara would love a Thanksgiving menu. So maybe that was kind of my thought here, was we'd start there.
Actually, you know what? Eating it with the squash, it helps. I bet if we blended it with either potatoes. Oh. I know, the squash is delicious, but you did eat the squash with the meat.
With the ham.
It helps to dissipate the texture of the ham.
The ham is really salty and delicious.
It is.
Like, I think I'm craving salt right now, so it just hit me different than it normally does. So here's the other thing. If you don't want to do this, get a dish that's clear. And then a couple weeks ago, we took baggies and we put everything in baggies and then we layered it. Like, we piped it out like you would decorate a cake. Dehydrated stuffing. I will work on that, Janet. Can I make stuffing and bring it to you to freeze dry so we can try that? Because we could even do...
Yes.
Like,
Thanksgiving because that's bread. That would fall into the bread club.
Okay. Maybe I'll take that sourdough loaf home and make stuffing out of it and then bring it back and we can freeze dry it and then we can do... We'll try it. It's a thought.
Yes.
Okay.
We can.
So, if you... I have ADD a little bit. I didn't realize I had it until this year, you guys. So, I'm sorry. If I get off track, just yell at me. Pipe things into your glass and then eat them out of a beautiful...
This is one where the squash and the meat together would have been fine.
It's
put your softest at the bottom and then the meat on top and then just eat it like a parfait.
And the other thing we have discovered is that when you layer things, the thing that you get the most, because it hits your nose first, is whatever's on top.
So put your favorite flavor on top.
So put your favorite flavor on top. Mm-hmm. Yeah. What'd we get to with our...
I don't know. Look.
We covered the, like, symptoms and risks.
So this is everything that we wanted to talk about tonight. And I think we got to right here.
So we didn't cover diagnosis in general. So let's cover that real quick.
So how do they diagnose esophageal issues? So an endoscopy where they go down with a camera and look at your esophagus. They can even take a biopsy or take a little bit of the tissue.
They just
take
a chunk and then they test it.
And then they test it. So endoscopy, a barium swallow, which is essentially an upper GI. They'll look at the esophagus. It is a barium swallow is different than a modified barium swallow. Modified barium swallow, typically, the majority of the study is from the throat up. So it is looking more at the oral and the pharyngeal phase, whereas a barium swallow is more of the esophageal and lower, a GI tract. However, some therapists out there will ask or have the machine go farther down and watch the esophagus at least a little bit. Manometry,
which we mentioned,
which talks about the pressure. And then pH monitoring. And from what I think one of you out there, you may be here now, has told us that you do it with a pill now. You swallow a pill.
So a lady that I work with had a manometry, and then she called it a Bravo study, which I was what's that? And
she goes, it's
where they check the pH. And I was like, oh, okay. So they basically implant a little pill on the side of your esophagus, and it's there for 3 days. And it measures the acidity that comes up into your esophagus. She said she could take no anti-reflux medications for like 72 hours.
Okay.
And she had really, really bad acid reflux. So it was hard on her. But I had the Bravo.
And the pH.
Yeah. Okay. So I didn't know they were different. So that's good to know. So no medication at all. Right. And that's what she said. So it's really good information for us knowing if you have acid reflux or regurgitation, because they're different.
Mm-hmm. They are different.
Acid reflux is what's in your stomach, comes up into your esophagus. Regurgitation means it never got to your stomach and it's still just kind of hanging out.
Or it comes up.
All the way.
All the way.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to come up all the way, but it may, if it goes in the opposite direction of what it should, that is called regurgitation.
Yeah. So you can ask, here's the other thing. If you're in these tests and you ask them to do something, the worst they can say is no. So ask. So like if they're not going to show the camera down your esophagus and you're like, hey, can we look and see if that stuff, like if there's anything going on, like can you aim the camera? Ask them.
Mm-hmm.
Ask them.
Most therapists will. But it's just not a lengthy study. They can watch it go down till it empties into the stomach.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. A good therapist would do that.
Yeah. So ask.
I shouldn't say that. That's not nice.
We'll forgive you.
Okay.
Shannon, get the full study if possible. Yes, if you can. So if food comes up, may not be associated with acid reflux. It may not be.
That's true. It could be regurgitation.
Mm-hmm. And there are other things going on there. So that could be I don't know. I'm going to leave it there because I was going to say something that I don't know is actually true. It was just my brain trying to think things out loud.
Yeah. So we do recommend that you go ahead and get those studies so that they can identify what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we can help with the rest, mm-hmm. or people in your area can help mm-hmm. with the rest, hopefully.
If they can send you to a speech therapist in your area, do it. If they don't, call us.
So the last thing that we were supposed to talk about, is the treatment of esophageal
mm-hmm.
dysphagia. So if you have an obstruction, they will go down and remove that obstruction.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have a narrowed esophagus and something gets stuck, you will know because things won't go down.
Mm-hmm.
I've had people call me. I've had, insurance doesn't cover a lot of speech therapy. You are right.
Insurance
Karen.
Covers even less dietitian. So,
or insurance will cover 3 visits or 4 visits. And honestly,
that's a joke. It's not a joke. It's important. Get what you can out of them. But
absolutely.
But we all need more than 3 visits.
That's why we're doing what we do.
Yeah.
However, if you have an obstruction because of a narrowing or because you took too big a bite, I've had people call me. I think something stuck, but I don't know. I say drink a fizzy pop.
For those of you that can.
For those of you that can, or you know someone that's having this, drink a fizzy pop. If the fizzy comes up instead of goes down, then go to the
ER.
ER.
Yeah.
Because they may have to go down and pick out what's stuck in there. Motility disorders, if you have a disorder of motility, of that squeezing of the movement down the esophagus, there's medications.
Mm-hmm.
There is Botox sometimes, depending on where the problem is and what's going on. They may relax part of your esophagus if you have a stricture. They may go in with a balloon and stretch it. If they do that, you may need to have that redone every so many years.
Mm-hmm.
But it depends. There are some surgical procedures. I don't even want to go there because that's way beyond what we do.
Mm-hmm.
But those are all possibilities. For GERD, for reflux, lifestyle modifications, diet modifications. There is some medication that I think it's important that if you're not managing it with diet, medications may be very helpful.
Yeah.
You don't want a continuous reflux of acid into your very tender mucous membranes of the esophagus and or pharynx and or
sinuses.
Nasal cavity.
Yeah. It happens. Yeah. And then treat the underlying causes. If we can figure out what's going on, we need to treat the root cause. If we can't figure out the root cause, then we treat the symptoms.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
Food coming up, see a diet. Well, yeah, because that's the wrong direction.
Yeah, correct. GI,
good
really,
call.
Really helpful.
Yeah.
However, for those of you that are having trouble getting into CGI right now, we'll help how we can.
Yeah, that's...
It's a lot of us, myself included. I can't get into C1, so they don't have space. It's all right. It's okay.
Okay.
Yeah. So we didn't get around to our pumpkin shake that we were going to make, and that's okay. We'll do it in a separate video later this week. I feel like you guys had a lot of great questions, and we had not as much information, but it took us a while to get through it, I think it's fabulous.
We did end up getting through it, but with the questions that we've had.
Heather, this will post. Absolutely it will. You got it. We'll even send you the link so that you can watch it.
Yes. So mm-hmm. just for everyone's reference later, these videos will always be posted in the group for 30 days.
Mm-hmm.
So Facebook will allow me to post it for 30 days.
Mm-hmm.
But I always upload it into YouTube. So guys, please go into our YouTube channel.
And subscribe.
And subscribe. All of our old videos are there.
Mm-hmm.
You can see early on dysphagia duo.
It was terrible.
It was.
It
was not terrible.
We were learning.
We're still learning.
We'll still be learning for a very long time.
We're constantly learning. Yeah. These ladies and gentlemen are helping us to learn.
Well, and here's the thing. we can't learn what to do if we don't know what you want. So we want to know what you want to know so that we can get you the information and help you, because we understand that not a lot of people are helping you. That's why we started this. That's why we're doing what we're doing, because it's hard to puree stuff. We have now failed at pureeing ham 3 times until today, but it turns out the way we had to do it, most people
can't do it.
So, which is not fair.
So we're trying to figure out a way to do it for you.
And we need to make it accessible to you. Yep. So that's what we're going to do. Yeah, Ivy, hey, we're here for you and we're here to support you. And just reach out to us. We'll do what we can to get you through this, because mm-hmm. we know that it's very traumatic.
We're passionate about education.
Yeah.
I think the more you understand it, the easier it is for you to work through it.
Yeah.
So we are truly passionate about making sure you understand everything that's going on with you.
Yeah.
With your body.
Yeah. I think that's a great place to end for the day.
Yes, because it sounds like we've got a little...
The puppies are excited, and we've talked for more than an hour. Well, we didn't used to... I can talk a lot, but I love when my talking is great information for you. So we're here for you. Take care. Please don't be strangers. We are going to help however we can. And we'll be back next week talking about anti-inflammatory diet, I believe is what we had. Or are we doing gut-brain connection next week?
I don't know. What do they want?
What do you want? Do you want anti-inflammatory or do you want gut-brain connection next week? You're welcome, Ivy. You're welcome, Karen. You're welcome. Danielle, I see you. Yes, I see you. Okay. The screen turned off, so I was having trouble seeing. So let us know. I'll post it, maybe a poll in the group tomorrow.
Okay.
Anti-inflammatory.
You got it.
So we'll do that next week, and we'll do gut brain in 2 weeks.
Sounds good.
All right, everybody. See you later.